As NBC's The Blacklist concludes its 10th and final season,
it seems like an opportune time for a retrospective into the series to determine if the writers and producers have achieved the story goals that they set out to address. This video will focus, with major spoilers, on whether the most important story thread, the identity of Raymond Reddington, makes sense within the context of the series.
This is going to be one hell of a ride.
This identity was not always an important plot point, but rather evolved out of a different mystery that had been baked into the actual premise of the show. Originally, the question was Reddington's connection to Elizabeth Keen, which served as a moderately clever way to introduce the audience to the series. Yes, it was a mystery box, but it gave the writers an excuse to place a young agent on a task force outside her level of experience and seniority. Agent Keen's ignorance placed her closer to the audience's perspective, allowing the other agents to teach her, and by extension the viewer, how the investigation's process would work during the series. The connection also fostered some short-lived distrust among the other agents on the task force, driving drama during the lulls between investigative scenes. And it created some subsequent interest in the character and relationship development between the dyad protagonists. But as the story progressed, I suspect that interest in the answer to that question waned as the audience put transparent puzzle pieces together. So the producers needed to transition to one that could better advance the mystery. They developed it slowly, first establishing that Reddington is not who he says he is, then shifting the narrative toward finding out his actual identity. Small clues that Reddington might be an imposter began to arise even in the first season.
I was a lifeguard my junior year in high school. Had to give mouth-to-mouth to Mrs. Bierman. She belched up a lung full of corned beef and chlorine. I haven't been in a pool since.
I'm sorry, weren't you in the Navy?
Though we really shouldn't take Reddington's anecdotes at face value. For better or worse, the question of who is Raymond Reddington eventually ballooned into the primary arc, eclipsing everything the show had previously established. I say for worse because the shift between these questions created plot holes that cannot be filled with any of the possible answers.
I was nobody to him, and he devoted half his life to me. Do you know anyone else who does that? Because I don't.
Liz has a point here. Which is why, given Reddington's unqualified devotion to Keen, there was only ever an extremely small subset of possible identities. In fact, I count only two realistic options. Reddington is one of Liz's parents. Raymond Reddington was confirmed to be Liz's father at the end of season 4, but the need for a new mystery caused the producers to introduce the Bones arc at the same time. It wasn't hard to figure out that the Bones presented only two options. Either the Bones were Katerina, and Reddington, Liz's real father, killed her. Or the Bones were Raymond Reddington's, and Reddington is an imposter, who could then only realistically be Katerina. No other options would create the necessary drama. So, when the identity of the Bones was revealed, it became clear that the imposter is Liz's mother. As unlikely as it might have once seemed, the idea that Katerina Rostova became Reddington had been a popular fan theory for several years, even before the Bones reveal, dubbed by astute audience members as the Redderina theory. As the seasons progressed, the idea became increasingly plausible as other options were eliminated. It would eventually become the only remaining viable theory, despite the writer's red herring attempt to throw off the scent. The show even comes just short of explicitly confirming this theory in the last episodes of the 8th season. Based on all the evidence, and the showrunner's choice to completely ignore the question in season 9, I believe we can now consider the matter closed. Reddington is Katerina. But is this good for the story? Let's start by looking back at the evidence, which materialized much earlier in the continuity than one might expect. There are plenty of scenes in the first 3 seasons which can be and were recontextualized into evidence for the potential Redderina reveal, but this was clearly not the original plan for the character. It's unclear if the producers had even decided this when the Bones were first revealed, but I'll address the problems with the Redderina theory later in this video. As far as I can tell, the earliest intentional clue about Redderina is a statement from Mr. Kaplan at the start of the 4th season, before Reddington's identity was even in question.
I betrayed you for the same reason I just betrayed Nikos. To keep Elizabeth safe. Just like you asked me to all those years ago, when you first put her in my arms as a baby girl.
This was played at the time as a revelation of a deeper connection between Liz and Mr. Kaplan, but it became a clue to Reddington's identity once Mr. Kaplan's backstory was revealed in the episode titled Requiem. The clue is that the statement is a contradiction. Raymond was not the one who hired Kate Nemec as Liz's nanny. Katerina was. Reddington didn't appear in Kaplan's life until much later, well after Liz was no longer a baby.
Maybe I ought to start at the beginning.
The story of Redderina begins in 1984. seasoned KGB spy Katerina Rostova, was assigned by her father, Oleander, and her handler, Ivan Stepanov, to cultivate a relationship with Naval Intelligence Officer Raymond Reddington, and either turn him as an asset or simply steal classified information.
That relationship, which started as guarded attraction, quickly evolved into passion, which resulted in pregnancy.
Their child, Masha, was born in Moscow in the winter of 1985 and was raised by her mother and her mostly absentee stepfather, Konstantin Rostov, splitting their time between their primary residence in Novosibirsk, USSR, and a cottage on Cape Breton Island in Nova Scotia. Because of her ongoing duties in the KGB and her cover identity with the Bolshoi Ballet, Katerina hired Catherine Nemec as a nanny for Masha, and quickly grew to depend on her for guidance and other concerns. Katerina's affair with Raymond continued for 2 years, until Raymond discovered her deceit. Then he began a 2-year counterintelligence operation against her. In the process, he discovered the existence of the Cabal and assembled the blackmail file known as the Fulcrum. Once the information was collected into the Fulcrum microchip, Raymond kidnapped Masha, hiding her in a rental house in downtown Rehoboth Beach, Delaware. Once he disappeared, Katerina's contact with the Cabal, the Decembrist, Alan Fitch, ordered her to eliminate or discredit him. She chased him to America with her childhood friend Ilya Koslov and a small group of Cabal operatives. The resulting struggle provoked the 4-year-old Masha to shoot Raymond, and the house burned down without any of the agents finding the Fulcrum. Little did they know that Raymond had sewn the Fulcrum microchip into his daughter's favorite stuffed toy, a bunny named Mimi. Masha ran back into the burning building to retrieve the bunny from her former hiding place and was caught in the flames. Katerina returned to save her, and they were both burned in the process. With Raymond dead, Katerina entrusted Masha to Kate for 2 months. After learning the extent of her troubles, that the Cabal had turned on her, and that she was now being chased by KGB spy hunter Anton Velov, as well as the Osterman Umbrella Company, she reached out to Nemec once more, instructing her to give Masha to a neutral third party, Sam Milhone, so that she would be safe. Katerina then walked into the ocean at Cape May, New Jersey, to fake her suicide. Once she thought she was in the clear, she contacted Ilya for help. Deciding to join her on the run, Ilya devised a plan to pretend to be Reddington to collect the money used by the Cabal to frame and discredit him. Ilya's ruse worked so well that Katerina decided to make the change permanent, by becoming Reddington herself. Receiving multiple surgeries from Dr. Hans Kohler, as well as therapy from an unnamed source, Katerina recreated the man she once loved in order to build an infrastructure dedicated to protecting her daughter. She turned to her former handler, Stepanov, to obtain a starting point. Using Katerina's former access, Stepanov stole 13 packets of intelligence that she could leverage into a network over time. This included the one involving Neville Townsend, which impelled much of the plot for the 7th and 8th seasons. The series is filled with scenes demonstrating Reddington's parental love for Elizabeth.
Is there a force in the universe more powerful than a mother's love for her child?
But that is hardly evidence of Redderina directly. The same can be said for the many tongue-in-cheek references to Reddington being an imposter.
You've been to therapy.
God, yes. Therapy helped me become an entirely different person.
So I will now try to lay out the most important direct references to Reddington's identity that fit this theory. My goal is not an exhaustive list, just enough to make it clear. Reddington's attitude toward Jennifer contrasts harshly with his devotion to Liz, for example. He ignores her pleas for Ian Garvey's life, cares about her only insofar as she can help him find Naomi, then promptly accepts her request to never see him again. In his court case, Reddington presents as evidence a taped conversation between Katerina and Alan Fitch that he couldn't have known about, and which he never previously possessed. The only conceivable way for him to know about the call and the person who recorded it is if he were Katerina. This is because, unlike Alan Fitch, Katerina actually made contact with the blackmailer who recorded it.
But you also hurt yourself.
No, I didn't. Katerina Rostova did.
And then there's Reddington's final meal, cabbage soup and dressed herring, which is a popular dish in Russia and Ukraine, particularly around Christmas. Given how much he seems to dislike the dish, the choice is almost entirely sentimental.
My mother made it for me when I was a child.
At his final meal, Reddington tells Liz that his father excommunicated him, and only a few episodes later, he consults Dom for advice when he's considering the same punishment for Liz and Dembe. They have a conversation about the subject, in which Dom tells him,
"Do you want to know what I find unforgivable? You not seeing how forgiving I am."
To which Reddington responds,
"You forgave Katerina, but not me."
And Dom corrects him,
"I forgave my child,
Dom considers Reddington ungrateful for the amount of forgiveness he has received, and Reddington believes that all the forgiveness Dom has meted out is toward his daughter, Katerina. Really, that one could go both ways, but so could much of what Dom says to Reddington, including the very next exchange between them.
If Katerina were standing here instead of me, if it were she asking you, what would you tell her?
It doesn't matter, because she's not here and she's not asking.
But if you could tell her...
I can't!
To say he's conflicted about the situation would be an understatement.
Some memories you want to hold on to. Most haunt you like a curse.
Reddington's relationship with Ilya Kozlov often presents as a continuation of the Katerina-Ilya relationship as well. Here are a few examples.
Have I ever let you down?
Once, when we were children,
we pledged our lives to each other.
When we were six.
And a promise is a promise.
How could you possibly be willing to die in order to protect him?
All the characters are very careful about using their new names throughout the story, which often causes logical problems for the story, but in this case, it creates a long-term comparison. As an audience, we see both the past and the present Ilya relationships, and they are remarkably consistent. Incidentally, the red herring Katerina, Tatiana Petrova, is a bit of a strange case. Much of the evidence she presents doesn't actually point toward the Redderina theory. For example, her need to torture Reddington to learn about herself is really just a clue that Tatiana is not Katerina. This story arc is very poorly executed, by the way, but that's a subject for another video. Possibly. The fake Katerina arc doesn't really address Reddington's true identity until we connect him to the identity of N13, the spy who stole the Sikorsky archive. Katerina Rostova is N13. The Russians know it, Townsend knows it, Dom knows it. In fact, Dom reveals it in a way that directly confirms the Redderina theory.
You took it, but he has it. And so do you.
Into the eighth season, we also meet Ivan Stepanov, who is N13's contact in the Kremlin, but is also Katerina's handler. He uses the same dead drop method with young Katerina as he does with Reddington for the Sikorsky archive. He also seems to run the day-to-day operations of Reddington's intelligence apparatus, coordinating assets like Rakitin. This connection strongly suggests Redderina. The final clue I'll mention is the montage after Liz was shot. The imagery juxtaposes Reddington and Katerina interacting with Elizabeth in similar ways multiple times. It also shifts between first-person perspectives, fading into an image of Katerina from Liz's perspective, then shifting to Reddington's perspective, looking back at Liz. They see each other as they truly are for the first time. It's a nice touch of cinematography, which also continues within Reddington's perspective after Liz has officially died. It's also the final piece of significant evidence in favor of Redderina, and many viewers consider it conclusive. But is it? Before I start to dismantle the theory, I want to be clear that I have considered the Redderina theory plausible for a very long time, almost since the bones were revealed at the end of the fourth season. In fact, the idea that the bones were Raymond's became more clear in the early fifth season, because the new copacetic father-daughter relationship needed another bipolar jolt from the world's least emotionally consistent female character.
And I'm going to destroy him.
Whoever he is, he does do a lot of good.
Redderina became an obvious choice once Raymond was revealed to be Liz's father, because the producers could milk the uncertainty of it. There were many, many flaws with the idea, not the least of which were lines like this.
I'm not sure Elizabeth will ever be ready to learn about what you did to Katerina.
In fact, I only fully settled on Redderina as the correct answer to the mystery at the beginning of season 6, when my preferred alternative theory was closed off within the continuity. And I still maintain that Redderina is only justified by evidence created after this point. In other words, a new choice was made, then they tried to fill the gaps. There are three major reasons why I don't think the Redderina theory works for the story. The first is the fact that while keeping the secret of Reddington's identity is foundational to his entire mission, there are way too many people who know important parts of the truth. Let's start with the people who are supposed to know the truth. There's Dominic, Ilya, and Stepanov. Dembe learns it at some point as well. Despite how instrumental she is in establishing this story thread, it's actually unclear if Mr. Kaplan knew the truth of Reddington's identity, since the grave marker for the bones is a K carved into a tree, and as she digs them up, she says,
"I'm sorry, Katerina."
We are told later that Sam and Naomi also knew the truth, but only through recontextualizing information. On a side note, in the Redderina continuity, I'm not exactly sure when she even met Naomi or Sam. Seems weird, but not the biggest deal. This is already a lot of people, but they mostly have the skills and motivation for keeping the secret. So that's excusable, I guess. But they are just the tip of the iceberg. Every analyst in the Baltic's best seafood distributor bunker seems to either already know or be completely disinterested in the story being told in front of them. And none of them were targeted over the years by Mr. Kaplan or any other enemy. And for some reason, none of them was ambitious enough to try to use this collected information for their own benefit. Nor did they think to defect, even after Reddington's business was destroyed and they were presumably no longer being paid. This group of random strangers has been conveniently loyal for 3 decades regardless of the circumstances. But okay. Additionally, between his mobile response units and his multiple plastic surgeons, Reddington employs dozens of doctors, nurses, and EMTs. The story expects us to believe that Dr. Kohler and his nurse, Marguerite Renard, are the only medical professionals that know his real identity. But that can't be right. Many of the others have access to his medical records, which they also write, as well as his blood, which would reveal that he's female any time it's tested. There's almost 0% chance that Spalding Stark hasn't figured out at least part of it as well. But even these people have a professional ethical duty not to say anything. But then, there are the women. Though it's been toned down since the early seasons, Reddington is a bit of a womanizer. He's been intimate, or at least naked, with no fewer than 9 women by my count. Women who would at the very least notice scars. And the ones with animus toward Reddington, like Madeline Pratt or Josephine Moliere, have no reason to keep a secret. Admittedly, these characters probably don't know that Reddington is Katerina, but Ian Garvey proved that it's a large threat to Reddington for anyone to simply know that Reddington isn't Raymond Reddington.
Reddington's power is legendary. With this, I control that power.
Knowing that he was once a woman is the exact same information. It's just as devastating, but he willingly reveals it without acknowledging at any time how problematic it is. The second reason I dislike the theory is a bit more personal to me. I consider Season 3's Cape May to be the single best episode of The Blacklist. In case you don't remember it, after Elizabeth Keene supposedly died in childbirth, Reddington's grief guides him to the Jersey Shore, where he contemplates following Katerina's path into suicide. He then encounters a woman with the same idea, who unwittingly convinces him not to follow that path. The episode presents a somber yet heartfelt examination of the hopelessness he felt. By exploring his past guilt over Katerina's death, his hallucination offers him the opportunity to make different choices to help her, as well as a moment of forgiveness for the Hobson's choice he actually made. It represents a substantial advancement for Reddington's character, presents us with the single best anecdote of the entire series.
Have you ever seen the aftermath of a suicide bomber?
And introduces Katerina to the audience in a creative way, which the producers capitalize on in the following seasons. I recognize that there are many scenes and lines of dialogue in this episode, which can conceivably be seen as evidence of Redderina.
You tell me. Tell yourself. Say it out loud.
And the entire Fight Club vibe of the episode gives this impression as well, but only if you already know about the theory, which I would argue was not part of the story plan at this point in the series. But this point will dovetail with my third reason for disliking this theory, so I'm getting ahead of myself. If the theory is true, it cheapens the core of the Cape May episode. Katerina's feelings in these two situations are fundamentally different. In 1991, Katerina walked into the water to protect her child from the harm she would inflict simply by continuing to live. In 2016, Reddington is contemplating suicide because he doesn't want to live without Liz. He reenacts actions he took in the past without the context, while actively not acknowledging that they already happened to him.
I don't know your name.
Don't be ridiculous, Raymond.
Also, why doesn't he realize that he's watching his own past self? And why does his mental self-projection of Katerina call him Raymond? How does that make sense? Additionally, why would Reddington have such a visceral reaction to the very concept of suicide if he not only didn't experience the grief of Katerina's death, but also pretended to inflict it on the other characters? But really, he didn't even inflict that pain on his loved ones, as the only people close to him that don't know his identity are Liz and, perhaps, Mr. Kaplan. If Reddington is Katerina, all the best elements of the best segment of the show collapse. The continuity doesn't work, even though the producers tried to force the puzzle together later. My third reason for disliking the Redderina theory is that it catastrophically breaks the show's continuity, especially what was established in the first season. Let's start from the very beginning.
Must be good to be home again, sir.
From the very first line of the series, Redderina starts to fall apart. Newton Phillips is Reddington's longtime personal assistant. It is highly likely that he knows the truth, but that's not really the point here. Reddington considers Washington, D.C. his home. He attended the Naval Academy, sure, but that's in Annapolis, Maryland. Several of his anecdotes about childhood reference places in Michigan, and his early season best friend lives in Nebraska. None of those places are in Russia. For Newton Phillips to say this means that he must believe it, but there's not much evidence for why he should draw this conclusion. To be fair, the Reddington house is located in Tacoma Park, Maryland, which is well within the DC metro area, so maybe that's why, though I think it's weird that 30 years has passed without any acknowledgement of that home. But I'll get to that later. If we instead push forward in the first episode, we come to this.
We confirm it's actually him?
It's him, all right. Prints match, tattoos.
He is initially identified by his fingerprints, which is interesting because we also get lines like this.
He can't change his fingerprints.
He changed his face.
Identifying Reddington by his fingerprints could be explained by saying that he changed the database. It's a stretch, but it's workable. What isn't workable is an offhand comment after the Anslow-Garrick incident.
Lab tests confirm the blood was Reddington's.
Which means?
As I discussed before, blood testing completely breaks the Redderina theory, but this particular instance is more damaging. Identifying Reddington by his blood means that the FBI has both the blood they found at the crime scene, which would indicate that Reddington was once a woman, as well as a sample by which to identify him, which has to be a DNA match to the real Raymond Reddington for the dialogue to work. This creates an even bigger plot hole when Harold eventually tests Liz's paternity. The show had already established a comparative sample within the plot prior to Harold's evidence tampering to retrieve one. There aren't many ways to reconcile this detail, other than just memory-holing it and hoping the audience isn't watching carefully enough to notice. Incidentally, it has become commonplace for the producers to show this sort of disrespect to the audience when referring to the Reddington identity story thread. Take, for example, the scene where Liz finally reveals the identity of the bones. The producers throw clips from past episodes into the mix to create the idea that this had been planned all along. This one is particularly insulting to the intelligence of the audience.
I know the truth, Red, about that night.
It sure seems like that scene has something to do with Reddington hiding the truth about the bones, doesn't it? Well, not if you watch it in the first season of the show.
I know the truth. Red. About that night. About what happened. To your family. Do you want to know the truth?
More than anything in the world. But if you know the truth, Diane, then somebody else does too.
Clearly, there was a different plan for Reddington's character at the time, a mystery he needed to solve, rather than a secret he needed to keep. This type of cheap recontextualization, ignoring the original context of the scenes, happens again and again as the Redderina theory progresses towards becoming canon to the story. It may work on a casual viewer, but we live in the days of Blu-rays and binge-watching. I can't be the only one who notices. I'll give the producers some credit, though. When they tried to tell the story at the end of Season 8, they actually went back to the older episodes to incorporate them into the tale as best they could. Not all showrunners even attempt that, but it doesn't change the original context. When Liz remembers returning to the burning house to retrieve her bunny, Katerina responds that they were both burned. However, in Mr. Kaplan's memory back in Season 4, Katerina doesn't have the wounds necessary to create the scars Reddington has in Season 1. Her clothes aren't even burned enough to fudge it as an explanation. This is major evidence that the Redderina theory did not become canon until Season 5 at the earliest. The showrunners added a line to try to fix the problem after the fact, but didn't have the foresight to prevent the problem from arising in the first place. They didn't consider alternatives to Redderina that made more sense with what had already been established. Another part of Katerina's story involves watching over Jennifer in the Tacoma Park house, recontextualizing the memories Reddington had in Season 1 about a girl playing with bubbles in the front yard. Again, it uses the memory, but ignores the context.
Why this place?
Where is my family in this house?
Why would Reddington care about Jennifer's height carved into the wall? Why are these somber memories?
This place must hold a lot of memories for you.
I spend every day trying to forget what happened here.
Let's take this one step at a time. What happened to Katerina in this house? The answer is that Raymond Reddington discovered her betrayal, but how would Katerina even know that? Raymond kept it secret for another 2 years. And why would this moment be something Reddington spends every day trying to forget, especially when he wants to watch it as a home movie? It's as though there's a story here, something bad happening to his family while he was away, that changed his life forever or something. Maybe we should hear from Reddington on the subject.
I walked through the door. And there was just blood. All I saw was blood. All there
there was blood.
Now, I'm the first to admit that Reddington's stories are not to be taken at face value, especially this specific one.
Was any of it true?
But we do know he bases some of his anecdotes on real events.
You shouldn't use her like that.
Not here.
As a story to get what you want, it's disrespectful. Kate doesn't deserve that.
This one offers a nice view into the kind of emotions he's feeling in the first season. Why else would he fund a ballet company in exchange for a single private showing of Swan Lake on the same day every year? Because it's the anniversary of a show his daughter performed in 1987. He watches in sadness and imagines her on the stage. That scene is juxtaposed with a letter to Ressler about his grief over the loss of his fiancé. It's meant to demonstrate Reddington's perverse brand of empathy. The only problem is that this little girl is absolutely not Elizabeth. She was born in 1985 and lived in Russia. Even with Katerina's cover being a manager of the Bolshoi Ballet, and all the other references to Elizabeth being a ballet dancer in her younger years, she'd still be too young in 1987 to be on that or any stage. We know Elizabeth's birth year from her gravestone, after all. The first season's storylines strongly suggest that Reddington's entire family was killed, or their deaths were faked, in his absence on Christmas Eve of 1990, which served as the foundation for his criminal activity. His connection to Elizabeth has nothing to do with any of this. They are separate story arcs, which were then combined to make the Fulcrum arc, then morphed into the Reddington identity arc. Much of this early character development must be jettisoned for the Redderina theory to make any sense, so that's what the producers did.
You honestly don't see it, do you? How far in over your head you are.
There are some clearly better options, but they were thrown away several seasons ago. It's a shame, but that's the choice the producers made, and so it's what we got. Thank you so much for watching. This is my first video, but I have plans for more in the future. This particular topic was a bit of a passion project, so it might become an anomaly to the rest of the channel. My hope for the near term is to build a collection of review videos for movies, etc., in order to find my voice and create a baseline for an audience to understand my thinking about media. Longer analyses like these will continue if there's enough interest, from me and from the audience. Let me know what you think in the comments section, especially about anything I might have missed. If you liked this video, I would appreciate it if you clicked the little buttons below and consider subscribing to the channel. Thanks again, and I hope to see you soon.